Hi, it's only me yet again. I just thought I'd ring you. Can you ring me as soon as you can? Bye. Hi, it's Mary. Can you ring me? It's really important. I need to do really important. Now. Thanks. Bye. Time. Can you ring me when you get in, please? Bye. Hi, Tate. It's only Mary. Can you give us a ring when you get back or when you read your messages? Bye.
Tate, it's Colton. Can you give us a ring? It means. Cheers, mate. Tom, can you ring us back because he's dead?
What's he also saying?
We're worried. Will you ring us straight back as soon as you can?
They were found in this Range Rover. All three men were shot through the head at point-blank range. Detectives believe the killings have all the hallmarks of a gangland murder.
On December the 6th, they died in a hail of bullets.
Hello, Bruce.
Yeah, what's the problem, sir?
We've just drove down our farm track.
Yeah.
Go and feed our pheasants. We've come across a Range Rover with three people in it.
Yeah.
It appears that they're dead. I don't know what's happening. Blood in the motor all over them. It's White House Farm, Rettenden.
White House Farm,
Rettenden. If you come just past...
Hold on. Yeah, didn't you take a detail? Just say that a minute. White House Farm, Rettenden.
Yes.
Right.
If you come just past up the A130.
Right.
It's about a mile from the turnpike.
Yeah.
Going towards Chelmsford.
I'll pass the turnpike towards Chelmsford.
Yeah. We'll meet, there's a little lane,
right?
There'll be a green and white Land Rover at the top of the lane to meet you.
Green and white
Land Rover.
Land Rover.
Yeah, you better have an ambulance as well.
Right, I mean, are you actually with that vehicle now, are you?
We're standing next to the vehicle.
Right.
Shot. It looks, appears to have been shot.
Right, what are we talking about, males, females, or don't you know?
I think it's four males in there.
Three males,
yes.
And I mean, Is there any signs of life or what?
No, I've tapped on the window and I looked, we want to get past them obviously to get in the field.
Yeah.
I've tapped on the window.
Right.
And they've not moved, and when I've looked, there's blood all over them. And,
right, sitting there.
What's the number?
Yeah, you got the number of the vehicle?
The vehicle's number is...
Yeah.
Ready?
Yeah.
424.
Yeah.
N for Norman,
yeah.
P for Peter,
yeah.
B for Edward.
Okay.
Right.
And what is the Range Rover?
Colour?
Blue Range Rover.
The Blue Range Rover.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. And what's your name, sir?
It's the Jiggins.
The Jiggins. And where do you live?
I live in South Woodham Ferris.
Yeah. The address?
63 Guide Farm Road.
63 Guide Farm Road, yeah.
South Woodham Ferris. The farmer who's with me.
Yeah.
Peter Theobald.
Peter Theobald?
Yes.
Hold on, I've just written down Peter Theobald, yes.
White House Farm.
White House Farm.
Main Road, Rettingdon.
Main Road.
Rettingdon.
Rettingdon, right. Okay, let me just get this location so that we're certain. Right, it's the White Farm Rettingdon, yeah?
White House Farm.
White House Farm,
Rettingdon.
Yeah, and it's the A130.
The A130.
About a mile past...
Mile Chelmsford side of the turnpike.
Chelmsford side of the turnpike.
Yes.
Turnpike.
Yeah.
Okay, so we'll get somebody down there straight away.
Okay, we'll meet them. There's a little lane just past the farm.
Right.
We'll be waiting up there in a green Land Rover.
Right, okay.
Okay then.
Okay then, so we'll get an ambulance as well.
Yeah.
Try not to just too much, obviously, but I mean...
We've not gone near it. We've just walked up to it and walked away.
All right.
Standing about 15 yards from it, the phone.
Okay. All right, we'll get somebody in there straight away.
Thanks very much.
Okay, bye-bye.
I've been wrestling in Essex. The gate would have been about here, and the Range Rover would have been adjacent to this tree. Obviously, as you can see, it's a lot has changed from 24 years ago this year. They've tarmacked the road. The only thing that hasn't really changed is the lane, which I've just walked down. So yeah, this is it. This is the spot. What actually happened on that night? We know what happened on the night, but who done it? That is the question. Just find it really eerie, stood here, knowing what happened all those years ago, knowing that the three guys were shot right here. You know, and it's just an eerie sort of feeling, really. But what happened to the people when whoever killed them? How did they get away? Which direction do you think they went? Did they go back up the lane? Did they go through the field, which is in front of me, which is not a field anymore? Were they waiting in the bushes here? Were they waiting in the bushes there? Because obviously you've got to think this lane was so narrow. Did they fled along the track behind these bushes at the back there?
Essex is a nice place. We moved to Chelmsford to begin with, and then we moved to South Woodham. And that was when I was about 11 years old, and that was the time that I started to dabble with drugs, cannabis namely, and it sort of led from there, really. Essex is a nice place. I mean, it is full of what I would classify as gangsters. You watch these programs like The Only Way Is Essex, and Essex is nothing like that. Essex has never been like that. It's a glammed up show to portray Essex in the light that I've never seen Essex like that. I've only ever known Essex to be gangster related, drug related, party related. I haven't seen that side of things before. So apart from that, I've always been in Essex. I've lived around the world as well, so I haven't just lived in this country. But that was just purely because of what I was up to and how stupid I was being when I was a kid.
So could they have fled in this direction, which I'm sort of now behind where the gate would have been? This would have been filled. And in the picture of an aerial view, there's sort of tire tracks going off to the left if you're looking on the ground, or the right if you're going up from the shop, going up from the sky. Could they have fled in this direction? You don't know. Could they have gone across the field over there? We'll never know.
When it comes to Tony Tucker, Craig Ralph and Pat Tate and people like that, they were the sort of people, because I was young, I was like the young group, so obviously they had their adult group and they had their business, and then we'd filter through down to the young kids, and I was a kid at the time. So, you know, I only ever met them like once or twice occasions, and they sort of, they'd ignore you because you're not someone that they need to know. You're not of importance to them. But we knew who they were, we knew what they were up to, and that's why I got involved. And I was running bits and pieces all over Essex for people that were in direct contact through the supply from them guys. I mean, I know for a fact that them guys, if you was to have got an ecstasy tablet or used to do some cocaine or smoke some cannabis back then, you've probably got about a 70-80% chance it'd come through Pat Tate and Craig Ralph and Tommy Tucker and all of those people. It was, like I say, Essex was run by a couple of groups, and that was the group that I hung about with. And we had our own little, like, gang or crew or whatever you want to call them, or firm, and we'd work. And like I say, if I was to go up to them and go, "Oh, you're right, I'm thingy," they'd be like, "Go away, mate," because they were that organised, you know. They only dealt with people that were important, they only dealt with people that mattered to them, and they only dealt with people that made them money. And obviously, they never want to be tied or linked to people as young as I was in drug trade. Because, I mean, I know a lot of people out there, they've got their opinions of these guys, but they did have morals and they did have standards, you know. They were very, very rough and ready when it comes to hitting women. But they wouldn't think twice about hitting women. They wouldn't. I've seen it kick off the side. I'm not with them people directly involved, but you know, that was them back then, you know. And also, if you disrespected them, and it wasn't respecting, respect was earned, you know, you earned respect in what we were doing. And if you disrespected them, then you'd feel the wrath, or you'd definitely come worse off, you know. And that, those are the rules. You abide by the rules, you stick to the rules, and you make money. And that's what I saw I was in for. I'm not from a posh family or a well-established family when it comes to money things, so I had to earn my money. And the way that I earned money was through some ecstasy, cocaine, and I sold tons of stuff back then. And I made the money and I spent the money. Because, you know, you want to party, you want to go on holidays, you want nice girls, you want nice drink, you want nice clothes. That all comes at a cost. And that's the only way that I could find to make enough money to sustain that sort of level of party.
We'll be right back.
Raqules. I'm going to stand in the doorway. And that, let's see. Bernard O'Mahony would have stood out here also as well. This is also where, obviously, Mia Betts got her pills from, even though she didn't die of ecstasy. She died in an intake of water.
Hello?
The DJ booth for Raqules.
Yeah, I was Raqules NightClub. Bazard. You able to see me area, but I'm still fully intact. Toilets, toilet cubicles, all this stuff is still here. Mental.
Kitchen. Men's toilets.
Probably. Backstage, tables 6, 7, 8.
Oh, they've all been taken out?
Yeah.
Oh, come on in, let's secure it up.
Bro, I can't believe I'm in it.
Raqules.
So what's all this? What's this?
That's bars.
Taps.
Right, let's go.
What's up here? Can we get through to it?
That was the main room.
Ben, does that look here?
That's the fire exit to the roof.
I think we just turned on the main power in it, though. So I'd obviously like if there's anything.
Secure it up. The original carpet.
All the lights are out.
Stay away.
There's no lights in here whatsoever.
Yeah, I see. Let's secure up. Small room. Main staircase. Where Pat and Tony would have walked. Pat and Tony would have walked out on this. Every night. Alright, lads. Pat, Tony, and Colin. Night out.
I've always been this big. I've always looked old. My first time in Raqules, I was about 13 years old. And that was purely because I was taking ecstasy. I was going out with friends and we were getting bang on it, and that was the place to be. That and Southend was the best hot spots of the time. Raqules was, I don't know, it was a brilliant club. You walk in and the vibe there. And when the rave scene come along and everyone started taking ecstasy, honestly, it was like you love the world and the world loves you. And so there was never any problems there that we saw. And if there was any problems, then the bouncers, it used to be proper bouncers, they'd bounce you up the road. That was how bouncers are, not like nowadays where they would have the SIA license and things like that, and they would be governed and they're not allowed to confront people. If you piss bouncers off years ago, that's probably one of the biggest mistakes you could make. You'd end up down an alleyway, down the side of a club, battered the life out of. That was Raqules. Raqules was good also. The vibe there, the people there, it was all love. It was like literally the age of love. It was like ecstasy was coming out, and it wasn't really, I was only young, so I was only just getting into it. And then once I was in, that was it, I was in. I couldn't leave it alone. I loved taking ecstasy, I loved doing all the drugs and partying and the feelings. And also, Raqules, it was always good because everyone knew everyone. So it was one of those places. So you'd go there and you'd be like, oh, hi, how you doing? Oh, you alright, mate? How are you? You know, everyone looked after everyone. So if there was any trouble, it was taken care of, obviously by the Essex boys. They looked after that club, they run that club. And also what they said went, you'd never disrespect them, put it that way, because if you did, you'd come worse off than what you did. So you always abided what I'd call the rules, which is behave yourself. You know, never, obviously being young, you'd never talk back to an elder, otherwise you get kicked around the ear. Not like nowadays, where kids are walking around with knives and guns and telling you this and that. Things have changed a lot in Essex compared to what it used to be. So I love Essex. I'm Essex boy through and through, blood. And I wouldn't change my experiences for the world. You know, I've done a lot of things with a lot of people. Not all good, but it takes mistakes to learn life, to learn lessons. And so, yeah. I knew Leah Betts' cousin. I'd never met Leah Betts myself. The first I knew of her was when she was on the front of the page, dying with all the tubes hanging out of her mouth from the ecstasy. Now, I know her cousin, and I know for a fact Leah, it wasn't the first time Leah Betts had taken ecstasy. She'd taken it a few times previously, but unfortunately, when it comes to ecstasy, you're not meant to drink too much water. You're meant to sip it. Obviously, if you drink too much, your lungs, they fill up with fluid, and that's how you drown. Now, she was a regular at Raqules. She was always going there. So, yeah. I feel sad for her dying, you know. It's a sad thing to die from an ecstasy tablet, but the reason that she died was purely because she overdosed on the water. And that's the risk you take. But it's a risk you take when you take any drug, isn't it, really? I mean, the only thing I haven't heard of anyone dying on is cannabis, but ecstasy and cocaine, it changes and alters the mind, it changes and alters your body temperature, especially ecstasy. You know, you go really, really hot, you'd be sweating, you know, you'd be flooding out with sweat, you know, to the point where I used to take my top off when I'd go through the club, and I was quite a big lad back then, I was quite large, and I'd weave through the crowd. And you see people step aside because they can see this big guy who's sweating his nut off and walking through the crowd. And that's what it was. Drugs are drugs, you know. It's a sad thing what happened. But when it comes in relation to the Essex boys, obviously the ecstasy in the club was provided by them. So whether or not they directly sold it to her or not, which I know they didn't, whoever she got it through, which I do believe was a friend, it come from them ultimately. They were the source. So obviously her dad being the ex-commissioner of the Essex Police back then, obviously you're not going to take too lightly. If I had that sort of power and I had them people and my daughter had died, I think I'd probably done the same as what they done. And in my eyes, the people that are in prison for these Essex boys shootings aren't the people that committed the crime. It's a cover-up, and the police are good at doing that. But like I explained to you earlier, you know, when it comes to the police being proactive on drugs, they have to be known to be proactive on narcotics and the drugs that are going around Essex. So what they would do is they would work with the drug dealers, they would work with the importers. You know, I even had a friend, this is years ago, he got pulled over with 5 kilos of cocaine. The police took 3 and sent him on his way. So yeah, and he come to my house at the time, white as a ghost, sick as a pig. And I said to him, I said, you're a lucky man. I said, you've got 2 kilos left and you're not going to prison. You know, count this as a lucky day, my friend. But that's what they done. They would take drugs from drug dealers, they'd give them to other people to try and get involved in their circles to make it out to look like they're not undercover. And I know, and I had known of police officers back then taking drugs at the time to look like they're not undercover. And then when people's houses were getting raided, it was that they'd been sitting there the night before sniffing the cocaine with that was handed in the warrant. So, and this is the way the police are an organisation, so they're going to do what they have to do to be proactive on drugs. But the biggest thing was back then was they'd ask the main sources for people to raid. And what the main sources would do is they'd find someone that owed them a lot of money, that wasn't very reliable, and they'd give them more, and they'd tell them not to fuck up this time. Then next thing you know, 6 o'clock in the morning, their door goes through, And lo and behold, the police were proactive. They found a couple of kilos of cocaine, a few thousand tablets, maybe a firearm in there as well. It splashed all over the papers like the police are doing their job. And the police were on the back foot. They're taking backhanders, or were taking backhanders, left, right and centre. And they were all paid, and it was a job to them, you know. And that's why you see, sometimes you see these nice ex-commissioners in these lovely big mansions in their nice cars. You're not getting that off a police salary, you know. You're not driving around in your Jag off of a policeman's salary. It's just not happening. It doesn't happen. So yeah, that was the police back then. I mean, nowadays they're quite straight-laced and down the line, but it still happens. I mean, at the highest point, corruption is there, you know. It's like the government would never admit it. As long as the Prime Minister doesn't find out, then, you know, it goes like that. You know, as long as the PM doesn't know, well, what goes on behind closed doors is what goes on.
Location, and yes, I'm at Aldi, but this is obviously where we're going to be talking about. This is going to be at Pat's pizza place. Now, on the net, I have been scouting through the net to find out exactly where it is, and a couple of people have messaged me saying, oh, it was this place. There was a place called the Godfather in Basildon. And another person messaged me saying, actually no, it's in Whitford, which I am in. I'm in now. So you can see over there, Abbas Taxi Takeaway. Apparently that is where Pat's incident took place. I don't know if it's 100% true, but I'm only going with it, only because I got four people confirmed to say that is where it was. I want to say, I'm going to go with this place. And actually, one of the ladies in the group messaged me saying it's just down the road from her house, and she can remember like all the incident that happened and the police around and stuff. And she actually pointed to where this bargain land place was, just if I zoom in just here. But obviously, it's this place here, Abbas Takeaway. So, we're going to go here, and this is the place I'm going to say it's in. At the location at the King's Oak Hotel, and this is where Carlton first meets Pat, Tate and Craig Rolfe. They shot it, the interiors and exteriors here. If I just flip the camera around a second, they do a shot. So at the start, the shot will go something like this. You go down. And Tony's there meeting Colton as they walk in. I was going to take you in now and show you where they filmed. So they filmed up to the door. It cuts. And then they film a shot inside the door. They move along, the camera moves along, they're chatting. We move along, you see these two doors here. The camera moves down. Colton and Tony, they do a bit of coke before they go into the doors. Open the doors for a second. And this is the shot where Pat Tate is. And it'll be a shot like this. Like that. And Pat is sat just about here with his girls
with Micky Steele. And Colton and Tony, they come through the doors just here. And I'll take you back out in a second. This is all changed now. And then you've got Craig Dave's doing coke. Fuck me, is any Tom Cruise? And then it cuts to, back to Pat Tate and Micky and all the gang, and then before Tony chucks him out. So it's all changing here, actually. This is all changed. It's nothing like it was in the film, because they've had all this done up, apparently. They've had all the hotel done up. I'll just flip that camera back around in a minute. So I'm going to go back out now. So, yeah, this is the location for the first bit of Rise of the Foot Soldier that I wanted to see and wanted to show you guys. I am in Basildon. I'm actually stood on a train bridge, and this has lots of importance to the whole Essex Boys murder case. Let me just flip my camera around. I'll just show you these tracks, and you're wondering, some of you might be wondering, why the hell are you filming train tracks? Ah, Steve Nipper Ellis, the guy you tried to kill Pat Tate. I'm in a place called Timberlog Lane, which is around the corner from Gordon Road. And Steve Nipper, or Nipper as they called him, walked along these train tracks up to Tate's house and smashed the glass and started to shoot at Tate in 1994. But lucky for Tate, he wasn't killed. But Tate planned his revenge while he was in hospital, and he had a gun and under his pillow and was trying to lure Nipper to see him. But luckily for Nipper, he got a tip off and Tate was arrested for having a gun under his pillow in hospital. If you check out Rise of the Foot Soldier, you can actually see Nipper's events in the film, and the guy who plays Jimmy G is actually Nipper Ellis. So these are the train tracks here that he would have went along. Gordon Road is just around the corner, and Pat Tate's former home was right down the end here, so you can't really see, it's not a very good picture. So we're going to go and take you to Pat's home now. So we'll just walk. So Gordon Road is just literally round the corner. Now I want to be respectful of residency around here. You know, I haven't, you know, even though it's not illegal to film anything, I don't want to be standing outside someone's house with a camera filming, because they're going to want to know what I'm doing. So so I will walk on the other side of where Pat Tate used to live, just give you a little glance of his, was his former home, and then we'll go on to our next location. So Gordon Road is just here. As we're coming round, I've parked all the way at the top. This is Gordon Road. It's for cars. I might have to watch Rise of the Foot Soldier when I get in today, actually, I think. It's a nice little area around here, actually, to be fair. It's like some nice houses. Hello, Ryan. All right, mate? So we're now walking at Gordon Road. When I show Pat's house, I'm not going to stand there for very long, because it's not, you've got to respect everybody else that lives around here, and I don't want to, they'd be looking at some guy filming, didn't know what I'm doing. So yeah, the train tracks are just behind these houses here, and Nipper would have ran along these. If you haven't read the book, get the book Last Man Standing. It's really, really good, and Nipper tells a lot in there. He does say a lot of stuff which is interesting, in his own words, which is pretty cool. Morning, Gary. So walking along Gordon Road, and then I'll take you to another location, which is an old location, but I'll take you back there just for the new members and viewers of the of things. And then after this one I got back another two to do, so so we are approaching now nearer to Tate's home. Just up here. Oh, it's warm. It's really warm today. As you can see, that one with the car, blue car there, I'm not sure what car it is. This one here. That's Pat Tate's home, this one here. There we go. Up on the, you can see the road goes, not Gordon Road, but that's Pat Tate's. Nice little place there. Because I think this pub plays a significant part in what happened that night. So what I'm going to do is we're going to walk down there. I'm going to take my shades off. What I'm going to do is we're going to walk down there. I'm going to walk down there now. And we're going to have a walk along to the lane. And it will take us all the way through to the main lane location. Walking down here. Now I don't know what this was like back in 95. I'm not sure how, if this was all gravelled, or if it was grass like this, or if it's mud. Don't know. Never, you know, this is the first time I've been here. I didn't get to come down here last time. This playing a significant part. This could have been an entrance to where the killer or killers may have come down this track. They may have come down here. As we're walking down, you can still see the tyre mark remnants here. So obviously a Land Rover or something still goes through this, otherwise this would have been all over Gromler. So this could have been another getaway area for the killers, or killers, if you were. They might have used this. I don't think I could see them doing it by foot. That's a long time. If you think that, let's give an example. Let's just say the killers were parked in that pub, and they used this entrance, or location rather, to get to the main lane. This is a long way walking for 15 minutes to the main lane location, isn't it, really? So could they have possibly driven down here? That's another thing you can think of. Hi, Jamie. So, sorry for about the shakiness of my camera. Oh, it's a pain in the ass that you can't put it in the landscape. It just does my head in. Who films in landscape? I don't understand. But there we go. So, we're going to walk down. Now, I'm not sure how overgrown this is, whether I can get through. As when I looked, when we went through to the murder location last time, I could see it was pretty overgrown down there. So it all depends. It really, really does all depend. You come down in the winter time, I don't think it'd be a problem. And you got to think, we're crossing over, as we're walking down here, we're crossing over maybe 4 or 5 fields. I always said by that picture, that aerial picture, the tyre tracks going off, if you're looking at it from above, going off to the right or going off to the left, I always knew that that's another possible escape route, if you were, or getaway route. Ooh, it's a bit very overgrown to me. See how we get on. So we're still walking down towards where the main murder location is. Again, this is only a theory, it's not fact. For the people that are just tuning in, this could have been a route that they used to get there and get back out again. It's not a fact, it's just a theory. It's my theory, it could be other people's theories, but this is. Sorry, Pete, so I know it's a bit boring, but please bear with me, and you'll see where it comes out at the end. And I'll have to walk all the way back again and do it all again. So, imagine December the 6th, 1995, and they came down here. This is prime perfect, because it's out of the way of anything else, anybody else. It's out of the way of the main road, Retterton Hall. It's just out of the way of everything. And I think this is a prime location. At the end, near the end of the film, Mick says to Craig, he says, "Left up here, Craig." And Craig says, "Left up here, is it, Mick?" And Mick says, "Yeah." So that tells me that if the film was doing their research, that the Range Rover was coming from the Wheatsheaf pub end and not the other end. Because a lot of stories have said that the Range Rover and the White Cosy was coming from the other end, or the Turnpike, Retson and Turnpike end. So who knows? You can still see the little remnants of a track, tyre track here. Back there was 2 tyre tracks, but you can still see the remnants here. which is pretty cool. So we are nearly at the end. Oh, I can see Bretterton Hall grass just up here. Oh yeah, this could be a possible, not fact, but possible location to the murder site. So we're coming nearly to the end of this track. I can just see the entrance here coming up to. I should never put on this coat now, so what? So here we go. Ooh. Here we go, guys and girls. The main lane location, and I have just walked from the Wheat Sheaf through there all the way through here. This is the other field, and if I go along here, you can see the other lane, the main lane here, which ends. And if I bring you around here, oh, we have arrived. So that's how long it's taken. Where my finger is, that there, that's where the Range Rover was found, and the gate was just in front of it, and that would have been a field and not a memorial ground, and also that could have been an escape route as well. Yes, I'm at Barrowmount Lodge, and I'm at the former home of Tony Tucker. What's really nice that I got in touch with the owner of this house, Tina, and she's very kindly let me film. I'll do some filming outside. I didn't want to film inside, there's no point, do you know what I mean? Not really, really much to say about this place, to be honest. All I know is that this is where Tucker lived, and he bought this house for, I think, cash money. I believe, if someone can correct me, I think it was like 250k straight out. I could be wrong, but you go back to the 90s, that was a lot of money back then. But of course, what he was into, he could afford it. So just give you a shout. This is Tony Tucker's former house. Like I said, guys, I haven't really got too much to say about it because he just lived here, you know, and it's just a nice looking place. So this is Tucker's former home. So just want to say thank you very much, Tina, for letting me do some filming out here, which is good because I like that, because I get permission. If anybody stops me, I can say, well, you know, I've got permission to film, which is really, really nice. That's a better view from his house. There we go. It's a massive place. Lovely. God knows how much it's worth today. Probably a lot. But yeah, this is Tucker's home. So I'm going to walk back up now.
In my opinion, what I think happened that night, I think that it was executed with precise precision. They were lured there for a reason, whether or not it was to rob an incoming plane, as the theory says. But they were definitely lured there, 100%. They were lured there for one reason or another. And I do believe that the police or people connected to the police were sitting in wait for them and executed that execution. I know that they had problems with other rivals in the area, And so maybe I mean, I know that these guys that were in prison, they weren't guilty of that crime. They could have been involved. They could have lured them there. They could have given them the trap and got them there. But I know it wasn't them. And I've got many of friends that I know that I can trust that knew them directly, knew everyone directly, that have said, have also, I mean, it's been said for years, it wasn't them, it wasn't them. And these guys are serving 22, 25 years in prison for a crime that they probably didn't even do, which is harsh. But I mean, when you fuck with the old Bill, they're the biggest firm in this country. You don't fuck with it. It's not MI5, MI6, it's the anti-terrorism squads and all that. You don't fuck with them. If you fuck with them, you're going to come worse off. And you know, Leah Betts, his dad, he was in a high place and had high connections. So, who knows? But that's my theory. My theory is it was the police. It's just a bit coincidental, and nothing happens coincidental. There's no coincidences in this world. So it's a bit funny how the police would have had them same sort of shells, the same sort of guns that they could have got hold of. And it only takes them to plant them guns and them shells in these other people's houses, which they were good at doing back then, was planting stuff. I know many of the friends that have been pulled over in a car that had nothing in the car, and then they're taking the car back to the station, and lo and behold, tied into a seat underneath the back seat was a kilo of Class A drugs, or a few thousand ecstasy tablets, or a kilo of cannabis, something like that, that wasn't there. And these people were the same as me. If you get caught, you own up. And the reason you own up is it's a lot easier. Also, you get a lot less time. You hold your hands up, you say, I was stupid, I was involved, I shouldn't have been involved, but I'm guilty. Because, the worst thing you can do is deny something and then get found out later, because you get a longer sentence. But also, if you lie, you've got to be a bloody good liar, because they will trip you up, and they will trip you up before you've even known you've been tripped up. And then they will have you by what I call your nuts, and then you're done for. So yeah, it's one thing I've always been brought up to do is never lie.
I feel lost and confused. I've been around. I've played the fool. Gotta find a way. This time the pressure's on. Can see the goal, my friend is gone. Life ain't what it used to be. It's such a terrible thing when you feel life ain't worth the living, and you're just treading water. But this time I must be strong. Read the signs, find my way home. From the edge of the border.